research on the foundations of quantum mechanics, in my view, is beneficial to society because it brings us steps closer to understanding the, you know, the fundamental nature of things. But when we talk about, you know, more, you know, daily benefits, certainly one thing is secure communications. And this is no longer a dream or a vision, but you can just, you know, go to some companies and buy almost off the shelf some devices that will provide you with secure communication channels. And, you know, many banks and governments are using that. And this is increasingly going to impact people's life. There are also already experiments about, you know, personal devices like, you know, quantum-based ATM machine or authentication devices. And this is important, and people will grasp instantly the importance of this, especially in an era in which, you know, security of information is so important, widespread, because everything is virtual. On the other hand, the sort of more long-term perspective of quantum computing on one hand is a little bit more fuzzy, because, I mean, what is interesting for people in maybe factoring, okay? Okay, searching is something that everybody does many times a day, but we know that quantum algorithms for search do not provide such, you know, impressive and exponential improvement. I mean, you, in fractions of a second, you can find everything on Google. So somehow, you know, this is maybe not the most dramatic, of course, improvement. On the other hand, it is clear that speed up in factoring is, you know, to date the most dramatic improvement. But that is maybe, again, more interesting for the industry of security, maybe for governments, maybe for the military, and not so much perhaps for ordinary people. And there we have to admit that, you know, in order to get algorithms and the power of quantum computers to impact problems in the daily life of people, we have still a long way to go. And maybe quantum simulation, for instance, is an example that I like to use in this case, because quantum simulation, for instance, for the development of, you know, new chemical compounds, new drugs, with a lot of saving of money in experimentation. This is something that people can grasp, but I would say that the most developments have yet to come, hopefully. And certainly, you know, at large, it is clear to people that development in information processing power is something which, you know, will have some sort of impact on their life, but in a sense, at the moment, somehow indirect, so to say. They are not going to have, you know, just a better personal computer for their video games or their word processing or their email out of this, beside, of course, security aspects. And other part, maybe the last part, which, you know, comes from quantum information, from entanglement theory and experiment, but maybe it's no longer just information applications, is all the field of quantum technologies like sensing, like metrology. And here some examples that people, you know, normally can relate to are, on one hand, this, like, for instance, single spin sensing or very low magnetic field sensing, which can be used for, you know, real-time imaging of brain activity and, you know, medical imaging and so on, which of course is a very big thing in an aging society like ours, especially in the northwest of the planet, so to say. On the other hand, also metrology looks, you know, very technical, very abstract, but the minute you tell people that you can improve, like, positioning systems by a couple of orders of magnitude, then they start being able to relate more to that. And there is more and more to come in that direction, where entanglement is used not as an information processing resource, but, you know, as a resource, physical resource that allows you to develop more powerful technological devices in general.